Hello to all. I wish you all a very good morning. We have with us today our Vice Chancellor, Professor Varun Sahni, our Registrar, Professor Y.V. Reddy, and our speaker for the event. On behalf of Goa University, I welcome you all to the 36th Foundation Day lecture of the university. It has long been a tradition at Goa University to have an eminent personality deliver the Foundation Day lecture on a current topic. Joining us today via the internet, we have a very distinguished personality in Dr. S.C. Mande, who is the Director General of the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research and Secretary, Department of Scientific and Industrial Research, Government of India, New Delhi. Warm and sunny greetings to Dr. Mande from Goa and a hearty welcome to our electronic meeting via Google Meet. Many thanks, Dr. Mande, sir, for graciously accepting our invitation to deliver today's lecture despite your hectic schedule. Dr. Mande will be speaking on one aspect of the hottest topic of the year, the COVID-19 virus. Friends, the topic for today is science and technology challenges of past, present, and post-COVID era. We will find out what these challenges are shortly. Our Vice Chancellor, Professor Sahni, will brief us on the accomplishments of Dr. Mande. Vice Chancellor, sir, the microphone is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Leo Macedo, and a warm welcome to everyone to this celebration of the 36th Foundation Day of Goa University. I hope that everybody is safe in these very difficult times. We are particularly grateful that in the current circumstances, we have with us such a distinguished speaker today to deliver the Foundation Day lecture. Goa University, of course, its history is coterminous in many ways with the history of the state of Goa, a statehood, and the creation of the university being almost simultaneous events. Goa University has always, in that sense, been emblematic of the state of Goa. We have had a very distinguished tradition of having leaders from India's higher education and scientific research system coming and delivering, gracing us on our Foundation Day and delivering the Foundation Day lecture. And today for us, it's particularly a delight to have Dr. Shekhar Mande with us. Everybody knows who Dr. Shekhar Mande is. He is the Secretary of the Department of Scientific and Industrial Research, Government of India, and he's, of course, also Director General of CSIR. A very, very warm welcome to you, sir, and we are very grateful that that you have been able to spare time in these very difficult moments to spend some time with us and to illuminate and enlighten us. Dr. Mande is a globally renowned structural and computational biologist. He was before taking up his responsibility as the head of the entire CSIR system with all of its national laboratories. He was director of the National Center for Cell Science in Pune. He was awarded in 2005 with the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, and he is an elected fellow of all three of our national science academies. We really could not have found a more distinguished person, a greater leader, both in institutional sense, but a thought leader to deliver the Foundation Day lecture during this COVIDian crisis in which we all currently are. Someone who's leadership as well as intellectual concerns, would really give us a sense of what the future trajectory of our science and technology system is going to be. We are all looking forward to hearing him on the past, the present, and the post-COVID eras as far as science and technology are concerned. Once again, a very warm welcome to you, sir. And I now request you to please deliver the Foundation Day lecture to all, everybody who is, this is being live streamed, so all members of the university community, as well as other well-wishers of the university, would be hearing you address us. Thank you very much. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Professor Sahani, for the kind introduction. And thanks also to you, Registrar, and Professor Priyolkar, for extending this invitation to me. The pleasure of giving this lecture is entirely mine. Let me project my slides, and then I can tell you a little bit about my own association with Goa University in the past. My father was a professor of physics in Goa University between 1986 and 1991. It is just the time that Professor Sahani mentioned that the new state of Goa had been formed and a new university also was being formed. So I used to go there as a student to visit my parents very often. Apart from that, one of the families of CSIR has a very showcase institute in Goa, the National Institute of Oceanography, that all of you are aware of. And that also has benefited tremendously by its association with the Goa University in the past and continues to do so even today. I had actually the pleasure of coming to Goa University 2 years ago when we conducted this academy workshop, Science Academy's workshop, on structural biology. And some of you might remember that the Department of Biochemistry and the Department of Biotechnology of the Goa University had helped us in conducting this workshop in the university then. So the pleasure is entirely mine. My greetings to all of you on the 36th Foundation Day of the Goa University. What I intend to do in the next about 35 minutes is to tell you about the science and technology challenges of the past, the present, and the post-COVID era, especially in the Indian context. What I want to trace a bit of a history, starting from independence of India, of the S&T, how it has developed here, how we are currently dealing with the COVID pandemic, the global pandemic, and how we should actually be prepared ourselves for the post-COVID era. That's my intention to tell you in next about 35 minutes or so. So our S&T journey post-independence is very fascinating. Many of you know, and the professors of history in Goa University would stand by my statement, that when the British arrived in our country, India's contribution to the global GDP was of the order of about 25 to 30%. It's enormous. So in the 18th century, India was contributing a major portion of the global GDP. On the other hand, when the British left us in 1947, this number had dropped to less than 2%. And that's absolutely phenomenal, again, that how over a period of about 150, 200 years, we lost a very, very preeminent position around the globe simply because a few handful of people from overseas were controlling our administration. But nonetheless, when the British left us in 1947, we did not have our own industry. We did not have means of self-sustenance, even in as critical areas as food production. Those of you who keep interest in history would recall that there was a very famous famine in 1943, the Bengal famine, as it is called, and that killed several million people. So a few lakh people died in the famine, which is actually unimaginable today. But that was the state when the administration was handed over to our forefathers in 1947. And we had to rebuild the country, and the country thankfully adopted science and technology as one of the very powerful vehicles of our development. And we should thank our forefathers that they hardwired in our constitution, Article 51A, and especially look at the subclause G and H of this particular article. The clause H of Article 51A states that we must develop scientific temper, humanism, and a spirit of inquiry and reform. That's very fascinating. There are few constitutions around the world which have ingrained in them the spirit of inquiry as a means of human development. And we should be extremely thankful to our forefathers for the foresight that they exhibited in hardwiring that in our constitution. With every other area, science and technology did not have proper public support in 1947. And the only organization which existed pre-independence was that CSIR. The CSIR itself, to initiate CSIR, the efforts started somewhere in 1933 when there was an editorial written in Nature about a public support system for S&T in India. However, the British government community forgot that. But then came around a very eminent member of the British Commerce Council, the Diwan Bahadur Arcot Ramaswamy Mudaliar. And he convinced the British in 1940 to start what is called as the Board of Scientific and Industrial Research, which then morphed itself into the CSIR in 1942. And there begins the journey of S&T with public support in India. So 26 September 1942, Arcot Ramaswamy Mudaliar convinced Sir Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar to move to CSIR headquarters, then in Calcutta, and initiate this activity. Today, CSIR is a chain of 37 laboratories across the country. One of them is in Goa, the National Institute of Oceanography. But post-independence, we were very quick in starting many other S&T organizations, such as ICAR in 1947, ICMR in 1949, the Department of Atomic Energy in 1954, and so on and so forth. And as luck would have it, CSIR participated in all the initial discussions of starting these new support systems for S&T in the country. But yet, we had now to face many different challenges that were ahead of us. The first and immediate challenge was, of course, to implement democracy. Most people in the world could not believe that a country of this size and a population of this size and so heterogeneous would be able to implement democracy very effectively. But our population was determined that democracy would be the way to go forward. And to ensure that every citizen of the country gets democratic right, we had to make sure that every citizen, whosoever is eligible, gets a voting right. And how do you ensure that? At that time, an appeal was made to CSIR to find out a means of saying that so-and-so person has voted and so person has not voted. And what would CSIR do? CSIR came up with the indelible ink that was developed by our National Physical Laboratory in Delhi. But till then, NPL continued to make the ink on its own. The same ink what we use today in elections was made by CSIR at the appeal of the government. And for those people who would like to see more glamorous examples of the indelible ink, they are here. All of us today use indelible ink when we go for our voting rights, to exercise our voting right. But if you were to look at the science and technology era in the pre-independence time, starting from pre-independence time, we can roughly divide this era into four or five different kinds. At the beginning of the century, at the turn of the century, the first 20 or 30 years, I would say, was an era of individual excellence. We had huge, tall leaders, in not only in science and technology, but across many different human endeavors that actually India contributed to the world. In S&T, there were people like C.V. Raman, Meghnad Saha, Jagdish Chandra Bose, and so on and so forth. We can go on taking names of many different people who contributed by their sheer individual excellence to the growth of S&T in the country. But the immediate post-independent era was an era of self-reliance. As I said, we did not even know how to make our own food. Our agriculture was in dire state. When the British arrived in India, at that time, it is believed that India's rice production, especially in the southern region, matched today's maximum rice production per hectare in the world. India was a rice bowl. Bengal was a rice bowl of production. However, since the British came in there and the kind of taxation that was imposed on our population, agriculture slowly became a less and less attractive option for people. and therefore we have to implement what we eventually led to the Green Revolution. And CSIR also participated in the Green Revolution by contributing to mechanization of agriculture. For example, the first mechanized tractor was made in the CSIR lab in Durgapur. The Central Mechanical Engineering Research Institute made the first tractor, and then what actually spun out as a company called Punjab Tractors Limited was in CSIR. The 1970s to 1990 era was essentially a technology denial era. Many countries around the world felt that India could be a superpower, and therefore every possible attempt was made to give any technology to India. And that is the time where our defense and our space stood up and told the world that if technologies are denied to us, we can make our own technologies. And the space, an example to there to see for all of us, how wonderful job that the Indian space agencies have done in generating all kinds of space technologies. Today, the world holds India in great awe for the technologies that what we have, all developed indigenously. The post-1990 era was an era of increasing globalization. In 91, country made a significant change to a different kind of economic model. And that's the era with the globalization, we became aware that we should be actually a global power and we must integrate ourselves in the entire global ecosystem. And we realize that in the global ecosystem, there is a role for intellectual property protection that exists. And once again, CSIR played a very stellar role in the intellectual property of the global era. So if you were to look at in this entire time period, what were the major contributors of our economy? What we see is that when we became independent, the dominant part of our economy was agriculture. But slowly over a period of time, we have moved over to the service sector and also to industry sector over agriculture. Whether it's good or bad is a different topic to debate later. But nonetheless, today our economy is more dominated by services than that of agriculture. And industry also, although the industry contributes to our economy, the manufacturing India capability is not to the expectation of everyone. So we must actually ponder about these facts when we talk of post-COVID-19, which I will come to in a while from now. What I want to actually tell you very briefly about the COVID strategy of the Indian S&T community, how Indian S&T community has stood up for the mitigation of COVID-19. And it is a very fascinating era by itself. All of you are aware that at the end of December 2019, there was a cluster of cases reported from the Wuhan province in China. This cluster of cases showed that some sort of infection is occurring with pneumonia-like symptoms. With this, the WHO, the World Health Organization, got alarmed and sent a team of delegation to Wuhan to assess what it is. And sure enough, by early January, it was established that the infection is caused by a new type of a virus, which was now named as Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus Type 2, SARS-CoV-2. Is because it's a distant cousin of SARS-CoV-1, for which there was an epidemic in about 2003-2004, but that epidemic was limited to countries such as Taiwan, Hong Kong, and so on and so forth. But SARS-CoV-2 promised to be a much worse epidemic than what SARS-CoV-1 was. And WHO was very quick to realize this particular aspect. The first of the cases in US was reported on the 21st January, and the first of the cases in India was reported on 31st January. In early February, the CSIR had already started thinking about the possible epidemic in the country of this one. A talk that I gave in Pune on 7th February, I mentioned there that we live in the era of Corona, and therefore it's our collective duty to start thinking that if the epidemic comes to India, how are we going to deal with it? Very little we had realized that this epidemic was going to assume the proportion of a pandemic, what we see today. The pandemic till now, till yesterday, had affected about 10 million people globally, about a crore people globally, and about 5 lakh people have already died of this pandemic. And we actually need to put in our collective thoughts on how are we actually going to deal with this particular pandemic in the coming time. What CSIR did at that time, so this is a rough timeline of the COVID, how it emerged. As I said, 31st December, the first this thing. And about on the beginning of April, about 1 lakh cases had actually crossed of the global deaths. Today, that number is about 5 lakhs. So when we sat down in March, early March, CSIR, group of people for strategic thinking on COVID strategy, we came across the challenges and the unmet needs of COVID-19. So all of us collectively together came up with these ideas that we have very limited capability of diagnostics, both capability as well as capacity. We have no point of care diagnostics per se, except RT-PCR. We have no vaccines and no therapeutics. We knew that the virus is highly infectious, and we knew that the virus causes respiratory failure in critical patients, and the biology of the virus was unknown. So this is the kind of thing one does not like to encounter. Where everything is unknown, one doesn't really wish that we encounter such a thing. But didn't the global health community warn us of some pandemic of this kind earlier? Last about 20, 30 years, the public health community of the world has always warned that the next pandemic is just around the corner. And consistently, we have ignored this kind of warnings. And that's our failure. In 1918-1919, there was a Spanish flu pandemic that swept across the world, and that also killed a large number of people. But since then, many epidemics had been breaking out around the world, but a pandemic of this, we knew, was just around the corner, and there it was earlier this year. With this, CSIR, we thought that we are well positioned to exploit some of the strengths of our preparedness and response, because at CSIR, we have proven expertise in DNA sequencing. We have proven expertise in diagnosis of rare genetic diseases. We are the fountainhead organization of generic pharma industry. We have sufficient expertise in engineering and medical devices. And we have sufficient capacity and capability in R&D in all these areas. And based on this thinking, we came up with 5 verticals in mid-March that we were going to work with. The first vertical was digital and molecular surveillance. The second one was rapid and economic diagnostics. The third one was new interventional strategies, including drugs. The fourth one was hospital assistive devices and the PPEs. And the fifth one was supply chain and logistics support system. This is roughly about mid-March. And then we sat down together, wrote this down, and we implemented this strategy immediately after the first lockdown in the country was announced. So by something like third week of March, we started meeting, the strategic group of CSIR started meeting, and that group has been meeting every day at 6 o'clock in the evening, even today. Since the third week of March, this group of people has met every single day in the evening to strategize and to take the work forward. In the process, we are also meeting large number of stakeholders around us, industry, academia, startups, and so on and so forth. And we were very lucky that when we started work on this, we had support from all the industries in the country. I have named just a few on the right-hand side. Reliance Industries, right from the top, that we got support. Mr. Mukesh Ambani wrote to me saying that how they would like to support CSIR in all the endeavors. Same thing with the Tata Sons, same thing with Intel, same thing with Cipla, same thing with Sun Pharma. So all industries stood up and said that we are with Indian academia in this war against COVID-19. And what we have today, in the last 3 months or so, we have covered some ground in all of these. And I'm very proud to announce that in terms of diagnosis, we have 2 new diagnostic kits which would rival RT-PCR. But these diagnostic kits, while being the same accuracy as RT-PCR, are much cheaper and much quicker. And both these diagnostic kits should be rolled out in the market very soon. Similarly, we have brought a large number of drugs in the clinical trials. The clinical trials of the drugs are going on. And in fact, one of the first trials is coming to a conclusion in about 10 days from now, And after that, we'll sit together and analyze the results of this trial. And we are very hopeful that at least one of these trials would be useful and we will have a medicine to contribute against COVID-19. The same thing with hospital assistive devices, whether it be the PPEs or the ventilators or the emergency hospital buildings that we can construct at a very short notice. And the same thing is true with the supply chain logistics and support system. So that's how actually CSI stood up and a strategic group together came together and designed these studies for our COVID mitigation stuff. But now we ask ourselves that there is a post-COVID-19 era and how are we going to deal with it? And I would like to highlight one point that most scientists in the country and perhaps around the globe missed a point. And that point we missed, I'll state the reason first and I will tell you what is the reason, what is the point that I'm making. And the reason for that point is that the interaction between the natural scientists, the S&T people in the country, and that between the social scientists is very minimal. That is very, very unfortunate that the scientists of the country and the social scientists of the country essentially work in two different silos. And that must be corrected very soon. And why am I ascribing this reason to this? Because the scientists of the country did not foresee that we are about to witness a massive migration of people from urban areas to rural areas. I'm pretty sure had the interaction between the scientists and social scientists been strong enough, the social scientists would have told us much earlier that there would be a migration of people from urban areas to rural areas. And I feel very sorry about it myself that we did not foresee this. But nonetheless, we'll have to deal with it and we will have to bring now proper S&T solutions so that the people who have moved back to rural areas find means of their self-sustenance. And I will talk about that a little bit later at the end of my presentation. But in terms of imports, we also learned that how dependent are we on many of the imports from outside. And this is pathetic. The imports like crude petroleum, we import of the order of about 6 lakh crore of crude oil every year from outside. We import gold, we import coal briquettes, we import petroleum gas, and so on and so forth. And not to talk about importing the very critical chemicals and drugs required to fight diseases such as this. And this side only shows that what actually we have been importing from outside. And there are S&T solutions to avoid these imports. And S&T solutions to avoid imports, if we were to actually do in future, would be to tap our natural resources and not the fossil fuel, but the agri residues. We have plenty of waste agri residues in the country. And if the agri residues are tapped, we could in principle convert many of these agri residues into biodiesel, into ethanol, into biojet fuel, into bio-CNG and bio-PNG, and so on and so forth. And technologies for all these do exist. Not that technologies don't exist, but we'll need a willpower to make sure that we become less dependent on the fossil fuel that is imported and become more dependent on the generation of our own fuel through the waste agri residues that is there in the country. Similarly, as I said, we have been dependent in the chemical sector on a large number of chemicals, including pharmaceutical chemicals. A large number of drugs are actually imported in the country. And they are all very essential drugs like paracetamol, the vitamins, some of the antibiotics like amoxicillin, so on and so forth. Many of these were actually completely dependent on the outside country. But the Department of Pharmaceuticals under the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers did a marvelous job a few months ago, and they came up with a list of 53 bulk active pharmaceutical ingredients, also called as APIs, and said that if we become self-sufficient or Atmanirbhar on these APIs, many of these problems would be reduced. And that we have actually taken up as our mission in CSIR to ensure that we can generate these APIs as economically as what we can do from the outside, as we can do from the import. Now, having seen these two examples, one of petroleum products and one of chemicals, we must distinguish between these two examples. The petroleum products go towards meeting our energy demands. The petroleum power imports go towards meeting some of the essential atoms for our society. While the chemicals we started importing for the reason of convenience or for economic viability. There is a significant difference between these two kinds of imports. Petroleum is required to meet our energy demands, while these chemicals we started importing not because we cannot make them here. In fact, till 1970s and 1980s, we were making our own antibiotics. The Hindustan Antibiotic Limited in Pune was perfectly capable of making all these antibiotics on their own. But for the sake of convenience, we started finding that importing this from overseas became cheaper and cheaper. And therefore, we became more and more dependent on imports than anything else. So the difference between the two, the obligatory imports and the imports for convenience, is actually a stark difference between the two examples that I showed you. And therefore, all of us collectively must resolve that convenience is not the way forward. We must be capable of doing our own technologies. We must be capable of our own manufacturing processes for the chemical sector, and not because we are actually dependent for the sake of some other obligatory reasons for the imports. And we should do that, and we will do it. We also are looking at a very big crisis in the energy sector in the coming year. And we should also have several technology solutions, for example, in energy storage in the coming years. Lithium ion appears to be an attractive era, but then we will change our focus from petroleum products to lithium in terms of import. And therefore, we must initiate R&D very soon on the substitution of lithium with something else, such as sodium or aluminium. And we must actually try to look for that. Similarly, the same case is with metals and minerals. For many of the metals that we actually have in the country, for example, even steel products, we import them from outside, because steel requires coke, and most of the coke that we have is of inferior quality in the country. We don't have good amount of coking coal in the country. What we have is a non-coking coal. But if you have a technology that converts non-coking coal into coking coal, probably we'll do better. So at the policy level, what we should look at is make this kind of suggestions. If you want to reduce import, one must insist upon the quality criteria, about a life cycle, and a guarantee. And I don't have to give examples of the COVID era. During COVID mitigation, how we have been affected by importing some of the stuffs that we probably should not have imported earlier. If you want to move forward for Atmanirbhar Bharat, there's a dream that the Honorable Prime Minister has rolled out for all of us. We must promote the public-private partnerships amongst everyone. Apart from public-private partnership, we must involve all stakeholders in the development of the country. And trust me, science and technology is a very, very powerful way of going forward. I showed you before I started coming into the post-COVID era, a few slides ago, that the only way forward is to trust the scientists. When I talked about how do we prepare ourselves for post-COVID-19 era, I forgot to mention that we must develop trust in the scientists. And as I told you an example a little while ago, that the pandemic of this kind was predicted by the scientists, the public health people, for several days. Scientists are also predicting other kind of calamity situations. And the foremost amongst all of them is the climate change. Climate change is real. And if you're not vocal about issues that scientists have been talking about, we are sure heading for a catastrophe. And if we want to avoid the catastrophic situations, we must listen to the detailed scientific analysis that people have done, whether it be the outbreak of next pandemic or whether it be the climate change. And all of us must develop trust in the scientists for this particular reason, the policymakers and the society together. For our country, the possible strategy to decrease imports would be to design strategies for recycle and reuse, to ban or restrict material products which are there for one-time use, such as plastics, and own up the environmental ownership protection as a liability for the future. So this we actually must do together. And lastly, before I hang up, I must say that the area that I feel very bad about personally is that we had not foreseen the reverse migration of people from urban to rural areas. And it is our duty, all of us, whether we are scientists or otherwise, to help people who are going into rural areas. Empathy for other human beings is our natural duty. And to exercise that empathy, we must come up with solutions to help people who are who have lost their livelihood in the urban areas and who are looking for livelihood in their own rural neighborhoods. And technology, once again, can be a very powerful tool for helping this. For example, if we can actually generate a very good infrastructure in terms of road, bridges, housing, and so on and so forth in the rural areas, that will be excellent. We must help our rural people in their education, their schooling, and as a means of self-sustenance, we can actually also help them with their artistry. The people in India are extraordinarily creative, rural areas, and if we can help them in generating artistry, we have a global market waiting for all our rural artisans. We must tell our people about means of self-sustenance. We must teach them skills so that they become self-sustained. They can live self-sustained life and a very honorable life in their own neighborhood in rural areas. We must provide them healthcare, and we must provide them proper energy solutions so that they are not affected by some of these calamities of the future. But the skill set is something which is very important, and that must be taught to the rural areas. And CSIR, for example, has number of technologies that we can take to rural areas, and we actually intend to do starting this week. There are technologies in the food sector, in the processing food sector. There are technologies in the agriculture sector, including catering to the aroma industry, which is a global industry. CSIR has had a very impressive program on the aroma, and we would like to take that forward to empower our rural population. So it's a collective duty, once again, of all of us to make sure that the people who have migrated back to the rural neighborhood, they must live honorable life even there. And I appeal to all the people who are listening to me that let us rise all together and make sure that we are a society which cares for every other human being. We are a society where every individual has an empathy for another individual. And we are a society where science and technology is one means of development, but the human angle is another means of human development, and we find synergy between these two. Thank you all very much for your attention. I will go back to the Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Sahani at this particular stage. Thank you once again for listening to me.
Thank you so much. Thank you so very much for that that lecture. Dr. Mandate, the lecture was so learned and so visionary, and I'm sure that we all will be benefiting enormously from it. We'll be thinking a lot about what you have said. And really, kudos to the entire S&T system of the country, and particularly to all the national laboratories working under your leadership for the way in which you have been helping to sort of deal with the COVID-19 crisis. I think that is wonderful, and we are all so very proud of you. Of course, you know, as you mentioned yourself, your association with our university goes back to your learned and noble father, who was our first the first head of department of physics of our university. And we are so glad that you were able to address us today. And of the many things you said, what particularly sort of struck a note for me personally was your plea that there should be much greater interaction between natural and life scientists on the one hand and human and social scientists on the other. I really couldn't agree with you, sir. I think that is something that is desperately needed, and we have to begin to think of ways in which we can do this. I mean, we must expand the our definition of science to include the human and social sciences. And maybe, the first steps, for instance, made by INSA, by now including some social scientists as fellows of INSA, maybe something on that lines can be thought about, that at least a few social scientists can be invited to fellowships or even associate fellowships of our national science academies to begin this process of interaction that you have indicated. In normal circumstances, sir, a lecture of such as the one that you have just delivered us would have you would have got a flurry of eager people wishing to raise questions, interact with you, explore the thoughts further. But given the configuration that we are in today, it's just a few of us in this room, and the rest is being then live cast to everybody else, so they can't interact with you. But I really, on their behalf, want to assure you about how grateful we are and how much we have learned from this lecture. I will now request our worthy registrar, Professor Y.V. Reddy, to kindly deliver a formal vote of thanks, please. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good morning to all of you. First of all, greetings to all of you on the occasion of 36th Foundation Day. And at the outset, I thank Professor Shekhar Mande for readily accepting and delivering an excellent lecture on science and technology in the past, present, and post-COVID era. Sir, you have clearly explained us the history of science and the role played by the science in the past and the role played currently and the future role going to be played by the science and technology in the country. And as Vice Chancellor has mentioned, you have rightly said that interacting with the social scientists by the scientists will definitely help in understanding the social phenomena better. And also, the last point that you have said is now we must work on how to understand and create an employment opportunities, education, and other things. In case of a reverse migration that is happening, people are moving back to villages, and how to sustain them is a challenging task. And now I think both scientists and social scientists must work and create a sustainability for the reverse migration that is happening. So thank you very much, sir, for readily accepting in spite of your busy schedule, and you have delivered an excellent lecture and in a lucid manner. So social scientists also will be able to understand what is the scenario of science in the past, present, and the future challenges, opportunities that are available in every field. So thank you once again for being with us, and thank the Vice Chancellor for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, one and all.